my prayer. Singing, well, good morning, Liberty. We're excited that you're here this morning, and we just want to invite you to come in and find a seat, and invite you to stand right now and join us as we just spend a little time worshiping God. We're excited about a great service. We get to honor some kiddos today, and it's just going to be a wonderful time of being together. So we're excited, and man, it's just a great day to be here with God and recognizing who He is. So we just love our Father in heaven. So would you join us now as we worship God? be seated.
Let's bow our hearts and minds in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just sang and proclaimed about your goodness and your mercy, your love, and also your faithfulness. And these come directly out of your word. Lord, I pray that in this time together, that as we look at your word, as we sing, and as we do other things during our time of worship, that you would be exalted. We pray that you would be the focus. And Lord, may you be glorified. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning, church. You guys are the warriors that stayed home this weekend, so we're glad that you're here. I'm Dane Schout, one of the pastors here, and would just certainly like to welcome you here. We've got a lot of special things going on today, and one of those things is we're going to be dedicating some children. Before we do that, here are 12 different children when asked, what is something wise that you could recommend to other people? What's some smart things that you can recommend? So here we go. 12 bits of, and I put in quotes, wisdom from children. So here we go. Number one, Hannah, age 9, says, when your dad is mad and asks you, so, do you think I'm dumb? Don't answer. Number two, never trust a dog to watch your food. That's Patrick, age 10. Number three, stay away from prunes. Randy, age 9. Number four, never tell your mom that her diet's not working. Michael, age 14. Amy, age 9, says you can't hide a piece of broccoli in a glass of milk. Number seven, if you want a kitten, start by asking for a horse first. Naomi, age 10. Let's see, number eight, there we go. When you get a bad grade in school, show it to your mom when she's talking on the phone. Number nine, Joel, age 10, never pick on your older sister when she's holding a baseball bat. Number 10, never let your three-year-old in the same room as your school assignment. Tracy, age 14. Tanya, age 11, when your mom is mad at your dad, don't let her brush your hair. And then last, never hold a running shop vac and a cat at the same time. One Sunday morning, a Sunday school teacher was dramatically teaching with full of expression some real young children about the Bible story of Lot's wife, who disobeyed the angel of the Lord, and when they were running away, she looked back and was turned into a pillar of salt. After hearing this story, one of the young boys energetically raised his hand. Finally, the teacher called on him, and the young boy says, when he was called upon, yep, my mother once looked back while she was driving, and she turned into a telephone pole. God does not give us grown men. He gives us little boys. God does not give us grown women. He gives us little girls. But in our scripture passage today, as we begin our time of dedication of children, Psalm 127 reminds us, yes, it is the Lord that gives these children to us. It says, unless the Lord builds the house, its builders will labor, building in vain. Unless the Lord watches over a city, those who watch will stay alert in vain. In vain you get up early and you stay up late, working hard so that you might have enough food. Yet the Lord gives sleep to the ones he loves. Behold, children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from Him. We're doing something here momentarily called child dedication. And basically, what is child dedication? Child dedication are parents who acknowledge their love for Jesus Christ, acknowledging what the Scripture says, that these children are a gift to us from the Lord. And that word gift is very significant. Basically, it's the same word that's used when a person goes and gets a financial loan. So basically, what Psalm 127 is saying is, children are a gift from the Lord. They are on loan to you from God. And coming with that is an expectation. Not just raise them any old way you want. Since they are a gift from the Lord expects us to steward and shepherd and manage those children well under the admonition of the Lord and under the wisdom of God's Word. And so basically what we have today is we have two sets of parents coming up to dedicate a child. Basically, they're coming up, number one, to acknowledge publicly before you, that's why we do it here, that number one, they have come to a place in their lives where they have acknowledged their need for Jesus Christ because He is the only one that made the sacrifice on the cross, paying the penalty for our sins as our substitute. He is the only one by which we can be saved, by which we can be reconciled back to God. So first, they're publicly declaring their trust and their allegiance as followers of Christ. And as parents, then they will publicly declare, I would like you as a witness to publicly witness us acknowledging our need for the Lord and that we desire, never perfectly, none of us, but we desire to raise this child in a Christ-like way according to the teaching and the guidance of God's Word. And so we celebrate today that we have a couple of sets of parents that are going to be bringing their child. I'd ask you to come on up at this time, and we'll do some introductions. And as they're doing that, would like to remind you, after I've told you what they're doing, what's not happening here. When we dedicate a child to the Lord, it's not making any side of statement that this is an act of salvation on the child's behalf. The Scriptures are very, very, very clear. Every person must individually, when they come to that age when they can fully understand, must individually receive and place their trust in Jesus Christ personally. And so our prayer will be that when they reach that age, that they will come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. But Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, it's by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not of your own doing, it's a gift of the God. It's not a result of works, i.e. child dedication, so that no one can boast about it. And so we're glad here, and this is sort of interesting, have you come to the center here? And this is sort of interesting. I think they sort of intentionally played a joke on Pastor Dane. Because we have Joshua and Megan Dirks dedicating Garner. And we've got Morgan and Mark Dykstra dedicating Dirk. So if I mess up, it's your fault. All right. So anyway, but we're going to take each one of you individual, and they've also been asked ahead of time to basically select a scripture or two that basically that they're going to read, and it's sort of a scripture that they want you to hear, but also on behalf of their child. So going to ask each one of them individually a question, and then we will proceed to that. So first of all, Joshua and Megan, Do you publicly proclaim before these witnesses that Jesus Christ is your only Lord and only Savior? If so, say we do. Joshua and Megan, as the parents of Garner, do you solemnly vow before God and before these witnesses that you will, with God's help and with God's grace, raise him in a Christ-like manner? If this is your desire, say we will. And Joshua and Megan, do you commit to modeling a life of obedience, a life of love, a life of devotion to Christ in front of Garner, raising him in accordance to the teaching of God's holy word? If this is your desire, say we do. Do you have a scripture passage to read?
Alrighty, so the scripture passage that we selected is from Isaiah 41. It says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand."
This is sort of special, but it also makes me feel old, because this couple comes up and I officiate their wedding. Now they have kids, and so just an amazing time. But this is always the test. Face parents. What's the full name of the child?
Garner Lee Dirks. Okay.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we dedicate you, Garner Lee Dirks. And Lord, we dedicate you to your mercy, to your love, to your grace. And Heavenly Father, I lift up Garner before you. I just pray that you would allow him to be a young man that grows up to love you, to serve you, and to acknowledge you as his Savior. Lord, I pray that you would just be with him, that you would strengthen him, that you would fill him with your wisdom. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark and Morgan, I will ask you the same thing that I just asked Joshua and Megan. Do you publicly proclaim Jesus Christ as your only Lord and your only Savior? If this is so, say we do. Mark and Morgan, as the parents of Dirk, do you solemnly vow before God and before these witnesses that you will, with God's help and grace, raise him in a Christ-like manner? If this is your desire, say we will. And Mark and Morgan, do you commit to modeling a life of obedience, a life of love, a life of devotion to Christ in front of your child, Dirk, raising him up in accordance to the teachings of God's holy word? If this is your desire, say we do. Have some scripture passages to read?
Yes. Thank you. Morning. We each chose our own scripture passage. This is from Deuteronomy 6. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, and when you walk down the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. It should be going on our fridge. I'll take the kid. Everybody.
All right, and our second is from Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Good morning. Yeah, I'm a strange looking guy, aren't I? Full name of the child?
Dirk Lee Dykstra.
Dirk Lee Dykstra, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we dedicate you at this time. We dedicate you to the Lord's mercy, his love, his grace. And Heavenly Father, I do pray for Dirk. I just pray that you would continue to allow him to grow and to be strong. Pray that, Lord, he would come to a time where he acknowledges you as his Savior, that he will love you and serve you and follow you. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's okay. These two families have also called Liberty their church family and their church home. And so I'm going to ask you to please stand, because we have an obligation to them as well, as brothers and sisters in Christ, and this being their local church family. So I ask you these questions on behalf of these parents. Do you, the followers of Christ who attend Liberty Evangelical Free Church, do you promise to support these parents in their desire to raise their children in a Christ-like manner? Do you promise to encourage them by praying for them? Do you promise to encourage them by supporting them? Will you encourage them through your words and through your friendship? Will you encourage them to remain faithful to the commitment that they just publicly made? If you desire to do so as a church family, please respond by saying, "We will." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, what a thrill it is to acknowledge and witness individuals who first of all love the Lord Jesus Christ, but also have a desire to raise children in a godly way, in a way that's according to the wisdom of your word. Lord, it's not easy raising kids today. Lord, there's just so many things that are contra to raising healthy children. And so, Lord, I pray that you would protect them. I pray that you would give them wisdom. Lord, I pray that the evil one would not be able to gain any kind of foothold in their marriage, but instead you would strengthen them. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. How about we acknowledge these couples and their commitment? Thank you. I want to ask you to remain in sort of a mode of prayer. And one of our elders, George Blom, is going to continue to pray for these families and pray for some of the other things that are going on at Liberty. Thanks, George.
All right. Thanks so much. What a great day to be part of this and fun to celebrate. One of the unique things that we do at Liberty, we consider ourselves a family. And we have had this for a long time, where when someone has just a need or burden, something on their heart, they can just stand. And we can come around them as just those around, and we just gather. We put an arm on their shoulder just to let them know that they're not carrying that burden alone. They're walking together, and that we just lift them up. So if anyone would like to stand this morning, and I know, boy, it would really be a lot to ask to these parents to stand again, but I honestly think it's a pretty special day. So if Dirk and Garrett could be risen, and that we could stand around them and gather. But if anybody else, I just ask you to stand, and then we're going to go to a time of prayer. So, all right. We can just do that. And family, friends, just gather around. We've got a pretty special baby expecting here that'll be probably induced this week. So just some really fun things. I'll just say I heard about God's love, but until I was a dad, I really didn't understand what it meant. And so what a special day today to be. So let's just bow our hearts in prayer. Lord, we thank you for today. Thank you for these families that have come to dedicate their children. And Lord, they're fussy. They got their own little spirits, Lord, and just like we are wayward. But Lord, your love continues. And by the birth of a little baby boy, Dirk and Garner, we just thank you for them. We thank you for the soon-to-be child born, Andres and Isaiah, and this their family that have had a long pregnancy, a pregnancy with many trials and uncertainty, Lord, but through faithfulness, they've carried it fully to term. And Lord, I just pray that faithfulness, I pray for the health of the baby, the health of the mom, and the support of the family. Lord, I pray as a body, may we truly understand that children are a gift alone, as Dane said. But that's a treasure. That's something for us to steward through our prayer and our time, our dedication. Lord, it's hard, and to do that alone is too much. May we as a body just continue to pour into the children and the young families. May we carry the word throughout our homes. May that just be a part of who we are. May that be our DNA, that the scripture and the prayer and the time dedicated to learning and knowing you. Lord, may us as parents, as grandparents, continue to have that. Lord, it's another special day. It's Memorial Day, a time of remembrance. Just as we come to communion, we remember your sacrifice. Lord, today, this weekend, we pause to remember the cost of freedom, to remember the heroes, the soldiers that are serving today, that are continuing to protect our freedom, but also those that sacrificed. As you sacrificed for us, they sacrificed for our freedom. Lord, I just lift up those that have the loss in their lives, whether that's a loss of a life, a loss of someone that is struggling because of the impact physically or mentally from the time that they served, Lord. We just thank you for them. We thank you for this country. Lord, I pray for this nation that is broken. As we send children to school, we want them to be safe. We want that to be a place to learn and innocence kept. And Lord, that was torn away, and we're reminded of evil in this world. The evil is not far. The evil is not just on the other side of the world. Lord, we just need you. We just pray that we can break down and truly humble ourselves. I pray for those parents and those communities that are broken. It's not just in Texas, but it goes around. Lord, help us as we just continue to struggle. But may it be a day of remembrance for them. Lord, we end that we get to come and gather to you, to worship you, to love you. Lord, I just thank you for who you are, for this body of believers. May you soften our hearts to the word that is coming to us. In your name we pray, amen. Thanks for standing and being patient.
I'd invite you to stand one more time as we sing one more song. I'm going into the message that Pastor Dane's going to share with us. And as we sing this song, it's just talking about the goodness of God. And let's just focus on that right now.
That away. sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you. You may be seated.
If you brought your Bibles, or you have a Bible on your phone or a Bible app, go ahead and turn to Psalm 31. Psalm 31. We're going to be landing there in just a few moments. But me being a former social studies history teacher, I always like to remind you of what tomorrow is. Memorial Day began in May of 1868, when General John A. Logan issued a proclamation calling for a Decoration Day to be observed annually and nationwide to commemorate the sacrifices of Civil War soldiers. The first national celebration of the holiday took place later that month, May 30th, 1868, Arlington National Cemetery, where both Confederate and Union soldiers had been buried. It was originally known as Decoration Day, and around the turn of the century, it was designated as Memorial Day. And many things that we do, Memorial Day, for a lot of you, it's, yeah, I get the day off. But hopefully it's more significant than that. And so if you are a previous military person, a veteran, or someone who presently serves in our armed forces, I want to ask you to please stand, and we want to recognize you for your sacrifice that you have made. Go ahead and stand. Yep. All right. Thank you. And as George mentioned, one of the things for Memorial Day as followers of Christ should be that we remember what Christ has done for us and the sacrifice that he was willing to make to undeserving people. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we now look into your word, and Lord, we pray that it could be something that we can place our confidence in, something that can become an anchor when our lives start to go a little crazy and wild. And Lord, just a reminder of who you are, and Lord, how you interact with your people. So open our minds, open our hearts, open our attitudes. Lord, I don't want this just to be information. I want this to be something that's transformation that is caused in our hearts and minds. So we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. A few years ago, I had the privilege of joining some other people from Liberty Free, and we made the trek down to Haiti. Many Hands for Haiti, which actually originated here in Pella, was our host, and there was a group of us that flew down there and basically just sort of took a look at the different ministries they had, and just unbelievable what they're doing, not to give outs to the people of Haiti, but to basically teach them how to be self-supportive by sharing the gospel at the same time. So not only do you have basic needs, but you have a spiritual need, which is 99% gone in this country. But there was one day where we got to get into the back of a pickup truck and drive 2 or 3 hours on these bumpy, bumpy dirt roads, and we went to a castle, a fortress, that was called the Citadel. It's in Haiti. You can see the picture on the screen. This fortress, this castle, was built on the top of a mountain, 3,000 feet above sea level. And as you can see, the only way you can get there, and this is modern day, is this little trail. You had three options to get up there when we were in Haiti. You could walk and hope you get there by the end of the day. You could pay some money to rent a horse to take you up there, which when every horse saw me, they went the opposite direction. Or you could go by motorcycle, and that was our option. going on these little dirt bike motorcycles with half of my body not on the seat, flying up to this thing, this fortress. This fortress was built in 1805. It took them 15 years to finish. It took around 20,000 people to build it, and unfortunately, thousands of them died in the process. And unfortunately, even more was they were slaves, forced labor. The outer walls of this fortress are 13 feet thick. Some of the walls are 130 feet high. This is a 100,000 square foot structure. There are 360 cannons and over 50,000 cannonballs when this was constructed. It was constructed because they were afraid that the French were going to come and try to take over their island. They never did. The goal of the emperor at the time was, I want this fortress to be able to hold 5,000 people, to protect them from the invasion, but also to feed them and give them water for up to a year, not having to leave this place. Amazing structure. Amazing fortress. 13 foot wide, 130 foot tall, stone structure. In the Psalms, one of the ways God describes himself in his relationship to us, and as the writer of that psalm has experienced how God has related to them, one of the several of the words that are used to describe who God is a fortress, a refuge, a rock, a shelter. And just one of the many examples that I could have chosen today is Psalm 31. In the first five verses, we see these words coming out: fortress, refuge, rock, shelter. And here's what Psalm 31, the first five verses, says. This is a psalm of David. He wrote it. And he writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Lord, I seek refuge in you. Let me never be disgraced. Save me by your righteousness. Listen closely to me. Rescue me quickly. Be a rock of refuge for me. Be a mountain fortress to save me. For Lord, you are my rock and you are my fortress. You lead me and you guide me for your name's sake. You will free me from the net that is secretly set for me, for you are my refuge. And into your hand I entrust my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth. I want to do two things today. The first thing is definitely look at the context, look at this passage. Why did David write this? So that's the broader general context, universal for anybody who follows Christ. But then I'm going to narrow it down simply because of our special day. I have a challenge for parents. A challenge for parents that's one of hundreds of different applications that this passage could be applied to. I'm going to just pick one of the hundreds and apply it to parenting and parents, to homes. First of all, the context. David is running for his life. He's running from cave to cave to cave in hiding. Why? Because his very own son and some of the people that he trusted the dearest have turned against him. So he is literally running for his life. And David reminds himself and reminds you and reminds me about the character and the love and the protection and the refuge that our God can be when life becomes absolutely crazy and insane. Maybe that would describe your life now. Maybe it doesn't, but I can guarantee you, if you're the typical person, you will have hundreds of times where stresses and strains and difficulties will enter your life in all sorts of different ways. And if you're most normally a type of person, there will be times, one or more times in your life, where you will experience severe difficulty, a severe trial. And in this, David wants to remind you, as many other psalms do, okay, take a step back, quit reacting to this the way a human should react, and think to yourself, okay, who is God and how is He relating to me during this situation? And so in Psalm 31, 1 through 5, you have all these descriptive terms. Verse 1, Lord, you are a refuge. Verse 2, Lord, you are a rock of refuge. You are, I love this, based on this picture, you are a mountain fortress to me. Verse 3, you are a rock, you are a fortress. Verse 4, you are a refuge. Verse 5, you are the God of truth. What does that mean? What you're saying here is truth. This is truth, you can count on it. Any promise that's in here, you can count on it. Throughout the scriptures, we see the same thing. Psalm 62, verses 5 through 8. O Lord, my soul waits in silence for you. My hope is from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. On God rests my salvation, my glory, my mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in Him at all times, O you people. Pour out your heart before Him because God is a refuge. Psalm 18, first three verses. I love you, O Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God. You are my rock in whom I take refuge. You're my shield. You're the horn of my salvation. You are my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I'm saved from my enemies. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help during times of trouble. Therefore, what's the therefore? Therefore. Well, based on the fact that God is a refuge and strength, here's how I'm going to respond when life gets insane. We will not fear, though the earth were to give way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. It's the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of it. She will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations might rage. The kingdoms might totter. The Lord utters His voice and the earth melts. Therefore, the Lord of hosts is always with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. As I mentioned before, sometime in your life, two things will take place. Number one, dozens of times you will have things that pop up that are unexpected, things that are creating fear, things that create anxiety. And then typically for the normal person, sometimes that climaxes on occasion into a very bitter, very disturbing, very anguishing trial. And what God's Word is saying is two things. When those things take place, I like what one writer says. It's possible that sometime in your life things will totally fall apart and you will feel that you have nothing left. Let me remind you of two things, he writes. Number one, God will never take away the gospel from you. In the most difficult of days of your life, you still stand before God. If you have truly followed Christ, you will be clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Your sins are forgiven, and no one can take that away from you. Second, God will never take away His promises from you. These two assurances will remain even if everything else is torn away from you. If you were brought to the point of even being like Job, where literally everything was taken away from him, these two things you can count on. Number one, you stand before God, clothed in the righteousness of Christ. The gospel will not depart, and He will never take the gospel away from you. And you will always have His promise, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. Verse 5, it says, into your hands I entrust my spirit. Two things there. Every Jewish child, when they went to bed in the evening, would say a prayer. And part of that prayer was, O Lord, into your hands I commit my spirit until I wake tomorrow. And this is what Jesus quoted in his last breath on the cross. Into your hands I commit my spirit, O Lord. Basically, that was a cry from the Christ, from the cross that says, Lord, I entrust myself to you. As I said before, that to me is the main context and the main purpose of this passage. But I want to offer a challenge to parents in my last few minutes. I want to offer parents a challenge to parents and grandparents. Because I think as you look at the Word of God, there's something that we can apply here. And it's through the form of a question. Parents, is your home a place of refuge? Is your home a place of shelter? Is your home a place of protection? That even when those children may be rebelling against everything you stand for, your home is still a place where the love of Christ and wisdom from God's Word is present. And everybody in that home knows it and sees it and feels it. Your home should be places of shelter and refuge for your children. Places of shelter, security, instruction, safety, unconditional love, and yes, discipline. What I mean by that is your home should be a place where your children or your grandchildren, when they're there, will experience unconditional love, unconditional care, yes, discipline, by individuals who are Christ followers and who are being transformed by the Holy Spirit, and your children see it very imperfectly. Can I mention that? It's going to be really imperfect compared to God. Joe White says this, there's no magic pills or potions that make us great parents. There's no magic deeds that guarantee our efforts will work. Great parents can have prodigal children, and horrible parents can have great children. Some parents have kids on both ends of the spectrum. Same environment, different outcome. No matter which kind of child you have, chances are that sometimes you've wanted to wring their necks. You may get so frustrated at their stubbornness that you want to scream, and sometimes you actually do. Well, congratulations. Join the rest of us. But our desire should be to be Christ-like, spirit-transformed examples in our homes, to the point where our homes become one of God's refuges. What does a home that is a Christ-exalting shelter look like? What does it look like when parents who love Jesus Christ and are being transformed by God's Word, transformed by the Holy Spirit, what are some things that you will see? I can't be exhaustive here. I don't have time. But I think it's these things. Number one, a place where mom and dad, or a single parent, is a follower of Christ primarily. And Christ is the primary driving force in that home. Glad I put my windows up. They love and serve Christ. They want desperately to obey God's word. They're very imperfect. But their children know Christ is our priority in this home. What is the opposite? Those of you who have been to the men's meeting have heard this a couple of times. What's the opposite of this? The opposite of this is called apathy. Where your children see in your home a completely different person than when you're at church. And sometimes you wake up on Sunday mornings and you're like, I'm just not feeling right. We'll just stay home. That's a big sign to your children. Well, I say Jesus is my priority, but when I'm at home, I really don't live it that well. Where the love of Christ is your priority. This is not behavior modification. This is not self-improvement. This is, I want you to see how Christ is living through me. And it's growing. These are homes, number two, that are grace-filled and grace-based. The opposite of that is shame-based and guilt-based. I can use shame and I can use guilt and I can get any child to do what I want. And it's very effective, by the way. You just shame them and guilt them and scream at them and holler at them and bargain with them until you get them to do what you want to do. There's a big problem with shame-based, guilt-driven parenting. You don't change the heart. You don't change the heart. Yelling and screaming is not effective at changing the heart. Outbursts of anger, causing constant fear of mom and dad, does not work. Christ is to be our example. Number three, there is sacrificial love and laughter that takes place in that home. If you have a home where there's never laughter, I really would wonder if there is grace exhibited there. I sort of had a policy when I was growing up. I have a t-shirt, or I should have a t-shirt underneath this shirt that says, very imperfect parent. One thing I was adamant about. Number one, we will eat supper together. And we had kids in 100 different activities. And when we eat supper together, that is not the time where we're going to correct. When we eat supper together, it's going to be a time of learning about each other's day and a time of laughter. And I, as the dad, needed to model that. Number four, that you are relying on God's word for your wisdom as a parent and not our culture. Which means you have to saturate your mind and your heart with this word. How does this apply to how I respond to this situation? How does this apply to how I respond to my children? How does this apply to how I create a home. Number five, good discipline. Consequences. You do this or don't do this, there will be consequence. And as a person who is married to a school teacher and to someone who knows a lot of school teachers, it is absolutely ridiculous anymore where when I was growing up with a teacher for a dad, 99% of the time you complain, the teacher is going to get the benefit of the doubt. Nowadays, 90% goes to the child, 10% goes to the teacher. And that same attitude takes place in the home. Number six, where a couple makes sacrifices for their children, but they don't sacrifice their marriage for their children. So many moms, your complete 100% focus is on those kids. And you neglect your most important relationship, your relationship with Christ and your relationship to your spouse. That is not to be. Those kids need to know, my spouse takes priority over you. And so many families where that's not the case. And then the kids are out. What happened to this relationship? Your primary goal is living for Christ and following Christ. And as a result, when that continues to grow and thrive, your home becomes a refuge, becomes a shelter. Where there's times at home, there's meals together, there's laughter, there's consequences, there's discipline. But it is a shelter, and those kids know it. Even in their acts of rebellion, just like the prodigal son, I know that home is awaiting me, and it's safe, and it's a place I can go to receive forgiveness and love without outbursts of anger and hatred and all sorts of other malarkey. Now, what this is not, home has not been created for you to completely shelter your children from the realities of the world. This is not a statement on school preference. It's basically saying there's a lot of parents who try to so shelter their kids from the realities of the world that when they grow up, they don't know how to handle it. Your job is to be a trainer. A trainer to release them into the world. That you're not making them so emotionally dependent upon you that when they're 28 years old, they still don't want to leave you. You're to create an environment home where you make children emotionally dependent upon Christ, where they are solid, where they are able to face the world and be in the world but not of the world, but still interacting with the world, because that's one of the tasks that Christ has given us. Yesterday, our next-door neighbor was moving, sort of an unusual thing, moved from this house next door to us to this house across the street from us. And truly amazing, because 95% of their move was done with a trailer about 6 foot by 8 foot, pulled by a riding lawnmower. Now, they had a whole month to sort of make that transition, but that's basically how they moved 90% of their stuff. A trailer being pulled by a riding lawnmower. To us, to give them sort of relief, Don and I says, hey, we're going to feed you, and we're going to feed the people helping you move. We're going to feed you lunch. You're going to come over to our back patio, and we're going to feed you. And so they came over and smoked some pulled pork from them. And my bride, you guys know her, We had the whole setting laid out for them. It was a feast. It was the buffet. And naturally, I gave instructions to eat and then didn't give them a choice, although our neighbors are followers of Christ. I said, let's pray. Here's what I prayed. I prayed, first of all, I thanked for the people that were willing to come over and sacrifice some time to help them move. Pray your blessing upon them. And then I said, as they move into their new home, three young kids, my prayer was this: may this home be filled with Christ's love. May it be filled with laughter. And may it be filled with God's wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen. As we're getting ready to end with a couple songs, let's go ahead and stand up.
Again and again and again. Oh, going to close our service today by singing about the incredible things that our God has done on our behalf, what that means for us. Let's sing this out together. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried.
Okay, so I open up the fire hydrant to parents, and you're like, where do I start? Two things. Number one, we're going to give you the official date soon, but at the end of September, we are actually going to be hosting a marriage and parenting conference. An individual who's booked out for over a year at a time, and yet was able to fit us in on a Friday and Saturday in September. Make that a priority. When we give you that time frame, make it a priority that, yes, I'm going to be attending that. And then secondly, how do I start? You start with your relationship with Christ. And here's what it says in 2 Peter 3, verse 18, the verse that I write in every graduation card that I give out. It says this: continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory, both now, today, and for the rest of eternity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God's people said. Thank you for being with us today. Make sure you congratulate our two parents that dedicated their children, but you are dismissed at this time. Thanks for being here.